You can kind of fall into a trance when bug hunting, walking slowly and quietly, scanning the plants and earth around you, hoping for specific sights. In my case, maybe the little mottled form of a jumping spider. I'm admittedly pretty spider-focused as a photographer, and it's come at a cost. I end up neglecting to shoot some arthropods and rarely take a closer look at them. For example, I've taken ants for granted in the past. They can move quickly and some rarely pause, making framing up a shot difficult. Last summer, I realized this glaring gap in my field observations and decided to pursue more ants in my area. And in doing so, I found a genus of jumping spiders that mimics ants I didn't even know was in my area, probably glancing over them in the past and just assuming they were ants. So, despite how he looks, the animal at left is not an ant, but a Cinnamacina species of ant-mimicking jumping spider. You might have noticed that he's quite different than your usual jumping spider, having evolved a really unique look. Zooming in, let's compare him to a potential model ant from the same area. Note that spiders have two body segments, a cephalothorax and an abdomen, while ants have three, a head, thorax, and an abdomen. And with some clever constrictions and markings, this creates a pretty convincing ant-like outline. But why? Why look like an ant? Let's ask someone who actually studies these spiders.
So, I think like one of the first things to cover is, why would spiders want to look like ants?
So spiders would want to look like ants because ants typically taste bad. Yes. They can bite, they can sting, and they come in large numbers. So if you pick on one, their friends are going to show up, and that's no fun. So ants are pretty unpalatable. They can be fairly dangerous. They're definitely uncomfortable to eat. And so predators tend to avoid them unless they are an ant specialist, meaning that they have some specialized morphology, or unless they're somehow specialized to eat ants.
So it's to their advantage as like a harmless little spider to look like a nasty, chitinous, bitey ant.
Yeah, something with nasty chemicals. And it's particularly birds and wasps. Oh, so mud dauber wasps and birds tend to prey on a lot of spiders. Mud dauber wasps paralyze spiders and take them back to their nests to feed to their young. They paralyze spiders, they take them back to their nests, and then put the live spiders in the nest for their young to eat when they hatch.
Mm-hmm. And they don't do that with ants. They don't target ants.
No, they do not do that with ants. They do that almost exclusively with spiders. And then we also have birds who really like to eat spiders because spiders are high in taurine, and particularly during nesting season. There's almost a preference. They really like to feed their young because taurine is really important to early baby bird development.
Mm. So spiders have what birds crave. Yeah.
Yes, exactly. So they have this like special extra amino acid. So they tend to like, I don't want to say they like specialize in spiders during that period, but they will have a preference for spiders. It's usually like the large orb weavers and stuff, but I have to imagine that, you know, any spider they see is probably fair game.
So, if you're perceived as an ant, you're less likely to be messed with. This view from above of an ant-like form on a leaf may be a common one for larger animals like us humans, but let's consider how this mimicry appears from different vantage points.
But you look at the sort of the three dimensions of the animal that the animal exists in. So, for example, in Cinnamacina, you know, a lot of their predators are aerial or larger than them, so we'll be looking at them from the top down, whereas conspecifics are going to be encountered from the side. And they'll also encounter predators that way and probably their models, but do they have different signals for different perspectives, right? Yeah. Like, do they have a more mimetic signal if you view them aerially, where a predator will probably view them from, or do you have a more mimetic signal from the side?
And from this low lateral view, note how Cinnamacina waves around his first pair of legs to mimic ant antenna. And in cooperation with these constrictions, markings play an important role in this disguise. Check out this light triangular patch on the side of the spider's carapace, a marking that helps create the illusion of a more isolated ant-like head capsule. I've noticed other ant-mimicking salticids also have their own variations of this marking, so keep an eye on that area as the video goes on.
Kind of creates like a little gap, or like a little like a cheek cut, kind of indicating a curve.
They're doing they do makeup. They do the contouring.
Yeah. You know,
Now we've seen how this disguise looks from above and from the side, but what about head on, looking into the face of the spider? Here, a female Cinemacina's palps closely match the angle and appearance of an ant's mandibles. And a posterior view really displays the effectiveness of a dark, glossy, and mostly hairless abdomen. In the field, I often confuse these mature male Cinemacina for Camponotus subarbatus, a common ant in my area, often found on the same plant I usually see Cinemacina on. But this multifaceted disguise and odd body have come at a cost. With the smaller, constricted abdomen, these spiders have low fecundity, or fewer babies overall, and don't seem to be able to jump quite as well as their fatter-abdomened salticid peers. Their slender body may constrain the ability to produce the sufficient hydraulic pressure required for a big jump. So, Cinemacina can jump, he's just a bit funny-looking while doing it. So far, we've been discussing just one genus of ant-mimicking salticid, Cinemacina, but there are actually multiple genera of jumping spiders that have evolved to look like ants. One of them is Pecamea, a small, excitable ant-mimicking jumping spider I often mistake for Chromatogaster species ants. This is actually the first genus of ant-mimicking salticid I became familiar with in Oklahoma, often spotting them solo, wildly running about. Aside from their unique morphology and behavior, they have yet another trick up their sleeve which offers some insight into other ways these spiders can get away with their ant-like disguise. I'll let Alexis explain.
So I just read this paper. I can't remember the family or the genus. I feel like it was Pecamea or Pecamea.
I used to say Pecamea, but the name would be Peckham, so maybe Pecamea.
Pecamea. Okay, I like that. Pecamea. So ants are very chemical-based, right? Mm-hmm. A lot of particular hydrocarbons and trail following. And so what they did was they compared ants and spiders and then this ant mimic. And what they found was that they just had very low cuticular hydrocarbons. The ant mimic did. And it was almost like they were hiding chemically.
Kind of incognito, kind of just...
Yeah, like chemical crypsis. Like, I just don't exist. Like, I don't have, like, a chemical profile. I mean, they had some, but they're significantly lower. And apparently the wasps that hunt the spiders used that as an identifying feature, so they were significantly less likely to face aggression.
Now, I don't know how prevalent this is, but it's interesting to learn that being chemically covert is yet another way these spiders may go undetected, or better yet, uneaten. Here, a female Pecamea grooms the tip of her left third leg. And the difference in eye color here is a visual effect of the spider's internal retina. Note that Pecamea holds her first pair of legs close to her face, while her second pair of legs are waved about, used to mimic ant antenna. This is a helpful character when trying to narrow down what genus you're looking at. In this clip, you can see how the darkened tips of leg 2 add visual emphasis to their antenna-like waving, while the lighter, more transparent tips of leg 1 minimize their appearance, making them less noticeable, even blending in a bit with light backgrounds like leaves. As for which ants they might be mimicking, I'm not sure, maybe multiple species, but I've always found them to be pretty Chromatogaster-like, and if I squint my eyes, I can almost see that distinctive heart or teardrop shape of a Chromatogaster gaster. And apparently it's really tough to ID Pecamea to species level at this point, and definitely not just from photos. So I'm not expecting an ID on this dark male I found in a New Mexican parking lot. Further complicating identification, for me at least, is Sinigelis, a close relative of Pekamia that looks very similar and also uses their second pair of legs to mimic antenna. But wait, there's yet another genus of ant-mimicking salticid here in Oklahoma, although to date I've only spotted once. And that's Sarinda, a very unique-looking jumping spider whose females have surprisingly thick palps. Maybe to mimic the mandibles of an ant? I don't know. With ant-mimicking spiders being so apparently common in my area, I've come to reevaluate how I see things to some extent, looking at mimicry, camouflage, and crypsis in a different light.
You know, a lot of animals spend a lot of time trying to hide and to not be seen.
Yeah.
Mimics are less concerned with being seen and more concerned with being misidentified, it seems like. It seems like that's the strategy. It's not to hide, it's not to blend in, yeah. It's not to be camouflaged, because you talk about, you see them sitting right there out on the leaf, right?
Yeah.
For any predator to come along and say, hey, here's a snack. And as long as they're misidentified, they should be safe. And so they have this very different sort of strategy to avoiding predation that's very unique. And it's the same thing for masquerade, right? Like you have this like thing that looks like a stick, and so it doesn't mind being seen as long as the thing seeing it that's trying to eat it is going to misidentify it as a stick and move on. And it's the same for mimics, right? As long as, you know, if a bird flies by, it's fine for it to see this.
Because it's just an ant. That's an ant. I don't need it. Yeah.
I'm going to leave it alone. But if that was a regular jumping spider sitting there, then it might be in trouble.
Speaking of regular jumping spiders, Phidippus, the American genus of large, fluffy jumpers, also gets in on this mimicry, although they don't mimic ants, but a type of wasp known as the mutilids, or velvet ants. Here's a Phidippus cardinalis I found in my backyard, who might be trying to appear like a Daisy mutilla species velvet ant, regionally known as cow killers, referring to their painful sting. So, even if this isn't explicitly ant mimicry, it's still a jumping spider trying to look like a potentially painful hymenopteran. On a 2016 trip to the Peruvian Amazon, I was fortunate enough to see multiple species of Fiale, a beautiful genus of jumping spiders that seems to specialize in this possible velvet ant mimicry. And I assume this is another multi-purpose disguise, as I can imagine them looking a bit waspy at times. This little speckled jumper had an odd, jerky way of moving that seemed very velvet ant, especially coupled with those orange spots. As for this bold black and yellow jumper, I could imagine a wasp or a velvet ant looking like this. Other non-salticid spiders also have some fantastic mimics. It was on this trip I spotted this amazing ant-mimicking crinid sac spider, yet another spider taking advantage of the look-like-a-hymenopteran strategy.
Yeah, it's an excellent strategy. So not only is it fairly widespread and has evolved independently in jumping spiders a few times, it's also in almost every order of the insect kingdom. There is an ant mimic. Yeah, so it's, I mean, they are really, you know, people see ants as kind of ubiquitous, and, you know, people who live around fire ants know that the danger that ants can pose. But, you know, a lot of people sort of see them as like harmless, maybe annoying pests that come into your house and eat your crumbs. So we don't really think of ants as these like horrible things, but to something that's maybe smaller or something that's actually trying to interact or attack the ants, they're quite formidable. And so what you see is a lot of animals, a lot of arthropods, a lot of insects say, you know, this is a good strategy. I'm going to look like this and nobody's going to bother me then.
Like you said, they're ubiquitous. Like ants often or usually look like ants. There's, you know, there's a lot of variation in what ants look like in color and size. But they often look like ants because they don't have to look like anything else. You know, like we're ants. We just roll with how we look.
Of course, there are a few caveats to my line of thinking there. as some ants definitely don't look like my mental image of a classic ant. For example, on mossy Belizean trees, one can find turtle ants, or cephalotes, a very unique-looking armored arboreal genus of ant that almost looks like it's bedazzled with rice. And there's a jumping spider that mimics them, Bellota, or Bellota, with expanded forelegs that may mimic the broad head and short antenna of cephalotes. Even this ridge here on the abdomen seems to be copied in the markings of the spider. An excellent example of how some solticids may be trying to mimic specific species of ant in their area. Let's continue this world tour of ant mimics to Gorongosa National Park in Mozambique, where I found a few amazing Myrmarachne species, including the slender male. Check out this dark patch around his posterior eyes, which mimic the enlarged compound eyes of Tetraponera ants. As for why he's got such large chelicerae, I'm not sure. This seems to be sexually dimorphic though, as females have more modest chelicerae that aren't so large or protruding. Here's a different Myrmarachne male, a bit darker, with a bit more hair. Once again with impressively large chelicerae. I found that ant-mimicking solticids sometimes have this odd look to their eyes, like there's some sort of crinkly texture behind the corneal lenses. No idea what's going on there. So, wrapping things up, think of all this as an open-ended introduction to ant mimicry in spiders. This is by no means a conclusive report on them, and there are surely untold things going on here beyond the grasp of my simian mind. This is an ancient relationship with motivations and nuances I can't access. And finally, I'd like to thank Alexis for her time and expertise. It was invaluable to have an expert to discuss this phenomenon with.
That's my ultimate goal, is I just want people to find them in their area. I want people to be pumped up about this because it's one of the weirdest, most beautiful things I've seen. And as someone that, like, I'm already enamored with jumping spiders, this is just a further evidence of how amazing they are.
Absolutely, and I'm like right there with you. I loved jumping spiders. That's one of the reasons that I joined Dr. Morehouse's lab, and I was like, yes, I get to work with jumping spiders. And then the first time I saw them, I don't know, I just have an affinity for like strange looking spiders, you know, like the ones that are just like yes, the Habernatus genus is gorgeous, and the Moratus in Australia are beautiful, like they're beautiful, and I'm obsessed with them. But then there are these little weirdos who can barely be called jumping spiders. They have this weird, like, lurching leap that they do. They're so, like, unjumping spider-like now. They don't even jump properly.
It's almost like they're becoming ants. Yeah.
Yeah, and they're so strange and alien-looking that I fell in love with them. Like, I can't help it. They're just so unusual.
So, like, some of the aspects of, obviously, why people find jumping spiders so cute or personable is that they're often very fluffy. And they have enlarged, almost like anthropomorphic, like cute baby eyes. The eye to head ratio is like cartoonishly cute. Yeah, just like almost like designed to trigger that, like the way people like baby animals. Yeah, they're cute. And it's weird to see that translated into something so ant-like, because
it doesn't look as cute anymore.
Yeah, it doesn't look as cute.
They're still cute, but they're weird.
Cute or not, I hope you'll look at ants and spiders differently after all this, as there's untold beauty and amazing relationships all around us. You can never look too closely. I still find myself fooled in the field, no matter how many times I've seen these mimics. If you have any corrections, comments, or questions, leave a comment. I'd love to hear your thoughts. Stay tuned for more videos on spiders, macrophotography, and more, and thanks for watching.